you so much for your presentation. Very inspiring. I'll continue in Portuguese. That's okay? Okay. Acho que a gente tem só 15 minutos para as perguntas, então eu vou tentar fazer uma pergunta para cada apresentador e tentar preservar o tempo para abrir as perguntas para o público, que eu acho que é sempre importante e às vezes a gente não consegue por falta de tempo. Vou então para as perguntas mais gerais, digamos assim, que estão ligadas à questão do Make It Right, mas acho que também a questão da trajetória profissional de ambos. Lars, eu queria começar com você. Queria que você falasse um pouco do que você mencionou, acho que um par de vezes na tua apresentação, que é essa questão da arquitetura ser inerentemente uma profissão comunitária, social, né? A gente não só mexe com aquilo que é comum, que é comunitário, mas a gente também só consegue efetivar o nosso trabalho em grupo, né? A gente está sempre junto de outros profissionais, com o cliente, enfim. A arquitetura ela tem esse papel que é sempre comum, comunitário, né? Eu queria que você falasse um pouco mais, o Tim também mencionou isso no final da apresentação dele. Queria que você falasse um pouco com os jovens que estão aqui, com os estudantes, que eu acho que em São Paulo, no Brasil, são uma fonte de mudança e de energia que eu acho que ainda é muito mal explorada, né, na nossa coletividade. Queria que você falasse com eles e, se tiver algum conselho ou quais seriam as tuas colocações para aqueles que estão aqui e que gostariam de se engajar socialmente como arquitetos, e como fazer para entrar, para se engajar dentro de um sistema político e social que faça a diferença e que mude a vida das pessoas.
Is that clear?
It's okay though that I answer in English, right? My Portuguese is limited.
As long as it's not in German.
Okay, I think architects, and you said that Tim, architects are in the center position of really changing the world. If you think of the definition of sustainability, and this is what it's all about, that we can continue to live a good life, and our children can, right? It's about economics, ecology, and culture. And I can't think of any profession that combines that better as the profession of architecture and planning. The problem is architects don't have the power. And also architects, and I think I have to give you that message, they don't make money. But as we're living in a new world, money is not the currency while we're in for it. At least, I hope you are not, because then you have, sorry, the wrong profession. You're in the currency of relevance. And that means you can't be afraid of taking risks, you can't be afraid to work with other people, and you can't be afraid to throw overboard opinions that you had yesterday. What you have to do is be very open-minded, work in groups, be strong, but also be curious. And curious means, good curiosity always means respect for the other. Otherwise, you will not learn anything. But if you do that, you will have moments of serendipity, moments of heureka, right? The Greek call it heureka, where you actually discover a solution to a problem. And if you follow your heart and you have the strength to do that, you can do something amazing with that. I'm not a rich person, and my colleagues are not either, right? Make It Right, if we would have known what it would take from us, we probably wouldn't have started it with Brad Pitt. It takes a lot for all the people, but once you do it, the relevance of something like Make It Right, and hopefully the solar kiosk, is just enormous. And that doesn't mean you have to have a lot of money. It just needs an open mind and conviction, right? But if you bring that together, you will find solutions, because you're architects, you will find solutions for designers. You know, same thing, how we produce things, it's super important. You will find answers to solutions that nobody else has. And if you do that right, well, maybe you get rich too. But first of all, maybe you get invited to something fantastic like this. I'm just thrilled to sit in Oscar Niemeyer building and you're listening to me. But that's only because I believe in things like making writers for the kids.
Tim, would you like to compliment?
So, just by a show of hands, how many folks got Tori? So.
Quantas pessoas que estão aqui sentadas no auditório têm menos do que 30 anos?
Damn.
Great.
So you don't need to be afraid to just walk up and shake the shit out of things. You need to be the agent of change. You need to be not afraid that you can do good and do well. But you cannot do that if you don't follow your passion. So you find your passion, shake it up a little bit, and good things will evolve. I've worked on projects that are $300 million museums and performing arts centers, and I get more gratification out of seeing somebody get their keys to their new home in New Orleans than any of those projects. And there are people and organizations and firms that pursue that type of project, and you need to follow that. But don't be afraid to put it down on the ground and say, this is what I want to do. It's not going to be easy, but you can do good and do well very easily. And so I would just, I don't know how to put that, then follow that passion and see what happens. It's not going to be the most money-making effort, but the design profession oftentimes is not, like Laura says. But the money that I receive is really the project and seeing that come to fruition. Very much so.
Okay, last questions, and then we're going to the audience questions. Como arquitetos, ambos estiveram envolvidos em situações de calamidade pública, né, de desastres naturais e talvez não tão naturais. E na cidade de São Paulo, como em grandes metrópoles ao redor do mundo, a gente tem talvez o que a gente possa chamar de uma calamidade diária, né, onde a nossa resiliência é testada no dia a dia, da nossa vida, né, na cidade. A gente tem, por exemplo, comumente um translado entre trabalho e casa que pode durar de 4 a 6 horas por dia, né? E hoje a Associação Internacional de Controle de Estresse indicou o Brasil como o segundo país mais estressado do mundo. E em São Paulo a gente tem um estudo que está sendo feito pela Associação de Saúde Mundial, que já está apontando que 40% das pessoas em São Paulo têm algum tipo de distúrbio de estresse, em maior ou menor grau. Qual, na sua experiência com essa arquitetura da resiliência, esses momentos com essas populações que viveram esses estresses, né, e que vocês tiveram que lidar, qual a sua posição e qual talvez o seu conselho para os arquitetos de São Paulo?
Well, that's an interesting one. First, I would like to give a plug as a landscape architect. You need to develop landscape architecture programs in Brazil. I was trained in America and studied Roberto Berlin Marx for many years. And landscape architecture is an understanding of systems, whether that be community systems, ecological systems, infrastructure systems. And I am just shocked, frankly, that it doesn't exist in this country to the level that I think it could. Landscape architecture is much more than just planting design. So that's my, I'm on my soapbox, I'll get off. The biggest thing and the easiest thing is also the most difficult one. And communities, whether it be post-disaster of a natural one or an ongoing economic disaster, need to become proactive as opposed to reactive. And so many of the communities that we've worked in across the globe immediately get into a reactive approach that does not look holistically at the impacts of social systems, environmental systems, economic systems on the ecosystem that it resides within. And so I would highly recommend a proactive approach at a sustainable systems management plan for things like infrastructure, parks and open space, stormwater management, many, many, many layers of that, and see how that can fit around the big idea. For what Sao Paulo wants to be for the next 100 years, as opposed to reactively fixing what has occurred for the past 100 years. And when you get into that mindset, into that process, you can see real change. And it's amazing.
Thank you. Lars, would you like to add something to that?
I think Tim, in a way, said it before for the other question. Your question is how you bring the stress level down, right? Love what you do. Then you have the passion. And it will be also, like in German, passion is translated Leidenschaft. Passion is also, part of it is to suffer, right? But it's good suffering. Meaning, if you love what you do, you have that Leidenschaft, you have passion for something, then suffering in it is also okay, right? Sometimes it must hurt, right? So you actually feel the relief and the victory. I really think for anything, really, it's a philosophical question. That's the only answer you can have for that. If you don't love what you do, you will suffer in a bad way. But if you love what you do, you will go through this suffer, but you know you will come out even stronger sometimes. So it doesn't have to do with like how we design cities today. It's a mindset, basically, right? What helped me was, besides the passion that you have, so many architects are just, you know, single samurai warriors, and they think their blade is the only thing that can cut the enemy, right? Well, I don't believe in that bullshit. I believe in team spirit, really do. Maybe that's my German heritage, I don't know. I just realized that I don't think I'm a bad architect or designer. It's just with my two friends, we're really good. And then with the teams we have, we can change something. Because also, you enjoy something that you win more with other people as you can go through, you know, a deep valley of sorrow with other people. So share this. Share this with other people. You know, be mindful of the others and play the ball fast. It's like a good football game. It's like be a team. Let the others run, you know, your teammates, right? But run as well so you get the ball back and you can score. It's I think architecture is a team play, and honestly I don't think that we will resolve any of the big problems we have today if we don't think as teams. And I don't mean just offices. I mean the Tokyo conference, the World Climate Conference by now, they don't have that spirit at all. They're coming with fixed agendas and they're trying to get something for themselves out of it. There's no team spirit there, so they won't change anything. You know, you have to have that mindset to be open. Only that way you can change something. Only that way. I think Giacomo Casanova said, love is three-quarters curiosity. You have to be curious about the other and listen. If you don't listen, it's like the only thing you can really do is be as genius as you are. Most people, as my experience, are limited, as I am, right? I'm bigger, I can be bigger than with others.
Thank you.
That's maybe the second lesson I learned.
So I'll start with the audience questions. A primeira pergunta que a gente recebeu é da Renata Souza Cruz, que é estudante, e ela está perguntando qual é a participação do governo nos projetos que foram mostrados. Então, no Make It Right e no Solar Kiosk. Would you like to start, Tim?
From a Make It Right standpoint, the government partnership has evolved. When we started in New Orleans, government was questionable. and we chose very specifically to work with the community and to be at arm's length from the government. And as that process evolved to working in other communities, we see a very strong alliance between the public sector, the private sector, and the philanthropic sector. And normally they have been separate. But when you can start to layer those opportunities and those partnerships, it can be a very powerful tool. When you can promote a vision that gives very real implementations, implementable strategies, and the community can see a win, the political movement can see a win, and private or philanthropic opportunities can see something that they want to support, that's a socially responsible project, and that can be a winning ingredient mixture for moving forward. And so our group has been received by welcome arms by the government in other communities, and I think it's because of that idea that everybody gets put skin in the game, that everyone becomes an active participant, and it is not just a one-sided yes or no from the community, from the government, or from our organization. It's a collaborative approach to changing the project into something that it could be better about.
Well, I know you have to be a little bit PC. I don't have to. if you start something, don't do it ever with any government. They will slow you down, they will steal your idea, they will spit you out dry. Honestly, I think innovation is not coming from governments. That's not what they're there for. That's not what they're known for. If you want to change things, start it with a really determined and great people that have the same conviction. You have to be a pilot, right? I think Steve Jobs said that. It's better to be a pilot than to join the Navy. Don't try to join the Navy. Be a pilot, right? And be fast. Because with a government, you'll never be. But once you're fast, and once you reach certain goals, at one point, well, yeah, the Navy will join you. If you want to have a big impact, I mean, at one point, there is no way, and there should be no way around governments or bigger NGOs. With a pirate ship, it's hard to organize a fleet of pirates. That's also chaos, right? But yeah, if you want to start something, that's at least my experience and would be my suggestion, do it by yourself. Once you're successful, there will be a lot of people that all of a sudden wants to stand next to you.
There's a very simple question here. Do you intend to apply the solar kiosk in other countries, other places in the world?
Yes, the idea is an idea that is relevant where there is a demand. We start with energy, and I showed the map. That's not just Africa. I mean, Africa is a no-brainer in many, many areas, but there are huge pockets of Asia, and there are big, big pockets of South America. Actually, we know that there would be a giant demand in Brazil, especially in the north. So the idea is really for all off-grid areas where this demand and the solution makes sense. And it can go in interesting different ways in terms of development and different business ideas around the kiosk. But you have to start somewhere. We started where it's probably the hardest in Ethiopia, because people really have no money. It's very, very tough. But there are 80 million people that really need this.
So once you scale, it's really interesting, again, on many levels. Now, but the idea, we want to see it grow globally. Probably the next step might be India. But yeah, South America has a demand as well.
That's when the Navy joins you, right? That's when the Navy joins you.
Maybe.
Tem uma outra pergunta interessante, this is for you, Tim, é do Vinícius, que no projeto de New Orleans foi considerada a possibilidade de se adotar uma tipologia, um modelo urbano que fosse mais compacto e denso, e que, portanto, mais coletivo, no lugar das casas unifamiliares.
So the focus on the dense development is really a conversation that around this idea of urban acupuncture. And it is focusing here. And that here sits next to public transportation. It sits next to commercial opportunities. It sits next to parks and open space, schools, and other type of development. And it does not expand until it's done, and until it's sustainable. Well, that mentality is very applicable in urban cores across the country, is that whether it's in Brazil or in America, the scale of the problem oftentimes is overwhelming. And what we have found to be very successful is that you have to put the blinders on a little bit, and you have to think strategically and focus it here. And leverage that dollar in from $1 into 2, into 4, into 10, until that community and that piece of community is sustainable. And that model has been successful in Kansas City, in Montana, in New Orleans, and in Newark, New Jersey, all across the country. And I have a sense that some aspect of that process is highly replicable in global communities around the country. The problem with housing or water maybe cannot be solved overnight on one big scale, but you can start addressing it very focused and very strategic. So that idea of urban acupuncture can transform a community and not just fix it for 4 years. That's not the goal. It's not to just fix something momentarily until the next election. The goal is to fix it until it becomes self-sustaining, and that's long-term. And if that means what it takes economically sustainable, or socially sustainable, or environmentally sustainable, you have to create and understand the metrics of accountability for the short-term impacts and the long-term responsibilities. Otherwise, you're just doing a project to do a project, and that's not the implementation aspect that we want to participate or collaborate with them.
Lars, I guess a gente tem a continuidade, acho que, de uma da outra pergunta na questão do envolvimento com o governo. A Luísa está perguntando, ela também é estudante, qual é a forma de financiamento do Solar Kiosk e quais as principais dificuldades que você enfrentou no projeto? E tem também uma pergunta do Bruno, que quer saber como você produz água fresca sem a ausência da mesma no local. Ficou clara a pergunta? As
perguntas? Ok, We did fund it ourselves as long as we could, and that after 2 years of sweat equity and designing, we built our first prototype with our own money, and then we didn't have any money left. So we had to shop around for a business angel. Again, we didn't ask for money from the government, and to be quite honest, it's not that we were against it. Everybody loved the project, nobody was willing to give us money, or not even that way. The German government wanted to give us money, but they had no programs for us. If a young startup, you know, it's really hard. All the programs they had were from big companies that go into Africa with already a ready product that they can mass produce, you know. There's just no program for it. So especially if in that space, we're really early adopters, the legislation is just not there yet. But we found somebody that made a lot of money in renewable energy and is now strategically investing in very, very different things and investing in the solar use as well. That brought us to where we are now. And now, is it only makes sense if it's hundreds and thousands, right? Well, that's not true. Every kiosk makes sense. Every kiosk creates its own business that is sustainable for the operator, right? But you need more to have the country level being sustainable. So each kiosk already, each kiosk is changing 7,500 lives. That's just the impact we have with each kiosk. So we have now almost 50 kiosks. You know, that's a lot of lives we changed. So it was already worth it. But the bigger thing, it's a little thing, but it's a systemic approach. The leverage is used, we have to do more. Now we're eligible for grants of, you know, the World Bank and so forth. We become bankable. Now people are interested, and so now we start talking to governments. But we're also talking about that space with corporations. Big corporations that realized that this is business, A, right? But it's good business. As you said, you know, you can do good and can do well at the same time. Here the beauty is everybody who wants to help is making money before anybody else does, right? So that's the sweet spot. But we're in negotiations with very big corporations, and we probably will not enter into governmental help as of yet. You also have to be very careful. There is help out there, but it binds you. The European Union has great programs. But once you have the money, basically you have to write a report every day for every dime you spend, and you become unflexible. Your business model changes, but you cannot use the model for that change anymore. So you have to be very careful how you do it. The other thing is that we see now, and that's interesting too, the legislation is not there yet as well. We believe in business and people. It's a human thing, right? We want to be accountable that we actually achieve something. If something is just given to us, we don't think it's worth anything. It's a poison gift. So more and more NGOs that do great work, but the money just disappears and great efforts are just evaporating because there's no sustainable, financially sustainable model behind it, are changing now. And we see now business ideas fusing with NGO ideas. But again, the legislation is not there yet. There are NGOs that want to work with us. They don't know how they can fund us because we're a for-profit organization. So it's a very interesting question, actually. In the beginning, you have to fight for yourself. You have to find the right people. And there are out there business agents that have money that want to also change things. And they might go for a higher risk to invest in something that means something, that is relevant. And even if they're just proud to do something great and they can chat about it in a cocktail party, right? But there are people out there. You can find them. At a certain scale, as I said, you need to go on the next level of corporations or bigger governments.
I can touch on the water. So we have been very successful in looking at two strategies with water. And it's running both stormwater and wastewater through a planting process and a planting medium that we refer to in the States as phytoremediation. And that is, you capture the water, whether it's gray water, stormwater, wastewater, and run it through a series of planting wetlands, if you will. And after that goes through the roots, it filters that water out to a final collection system that is potable or drinkable water. We've become very knowledgeable in that process, and there are different details associated with stormwater versus wastewater, but using plants to your advantage is a very powerful way to clean water, to turn it to drinking water, or some kind of water reuse very easily.
Okay, there was the other question, right? Of course we cannot clean water where there is none. We're not magicians, we don't create water out of thin air, which actually works. I think in Brazil there's a great company that actually produces water out of the moisture in the air. But anyway, we don't do that. We can only clean water where there actually is water, and it only makes sense to clean the water if it is dirty. But it's 95% of where we go. People go to marketplaces. You only have marketplaces or villages where people have water, otherwise they could not live there. So it really is an overlap. We haven't started with water because water is not a business case, or not an easy one at least. And you know, as I said, it's for business. With energy, you can do a lot of things. People don't have to buy solar lamps at our shop. They will survive. If they don't drink water, they will die. It's a human right to the water, right? All of mankind has right to water. So that's why the radical shift in people that have money, they can afford water, and others they can't, is dramatic. So we are hesitant to make it a business case. We don't want to sell people their water, right? So the only charge we would do is to charge for the energy that is necessary to clean the water and just give it to people. So it's not a business case, but it's a great thing to do. If you think on business terms also, if you have clean water, you will attract people. If you attract people, maybe they buy a solar lamp. Well, that's good for the business as well.
I think now we have to end. I think Shigeru has arrived. And thank you so much for your participation. Obrigada a todos que fizeram pergunta. Tem ainda algumas perguntas aqui. Não sei se talvez depois vocês possam conversar. Also talk. There's a lot of questions that weren't answered. So maybe you can approach them later.
Thank you.